Hello everyone, let's learn today norma basalis. Now this is the inferior view of the skull, and norma basalis is studied without mandible. So today we are going to discuss about norma basalis. Now for descriptive purpose, the inferior view or the norma basalis is subdivided into three parts: anterior one third, middle one third and posterior one third. Now let's see the demarcations. The anterior one third is including alveolar arch and hard palate and up to the posterior free margin of hard palate. So this is anterior one third. The middle one third includes from the posterior free margin of hard palate to an imaginary transverse line passing just in front of the foramen magnum. So this portion includes in the middle part or middle third of the norma basalis, and posterior third extends from this imaginary line to the superior nuchal line. Now we know superior nuchal line, these are the lines or the arching lines extending on either side from external occipital protuberance. So that portion is included in posterior third of the norma basalis. Now on either side, the norma basalis extends from the alveolar arch, and it includes the zygomatic arch, its posterior root of zygomatic arch and mastoid process. So these two are mastoid processes. So this is the territory of norma basalis, and as I mentioned, it is subdivided into three parts for descriptive purpose. Now let's study the anterior third of the norma basalis. Now as I mentioned, anterior third of the norma basalis includes the alveolar border and the sockets for the teeth. Now in the socket you can see certain teeth, and according to the sockets one can determine approximate age of the given skull. Now in addition to that, it includes hard palate. Now this is hard palate. It is having arch, and in the arch you can clearly see certain pits. Now these pits are lodged by palatine glands. Now let's see how this hard palate is made up of. It is made up of contribution from two bones. One is maxilla and second is palatine bone. Now let me show you both the bones separately. This is maxilla. Now we know this is palatine process of the maxilla, and that contributes anterior two-third of the hard palate. Now same thing you can see in articulated skull over here. This portion up to this suture, this portion is the palatine process of maxilla. So that forms anterior two-third of hard palate. And if we join both the maxilla, you can clearly see formation of the hard palate like this. Okay. So this is how the anterior two-third of the hard palate is formed. Now let's see posterior one-third of the hard palate. As I mentioned, it is contributed by the palatine bone. Let me show you separate palatine bone. This is palatine bone. Now it has got two plates, horizontal plate and perpendicular plate, as per their orientation in the skull. So let me show you the same in the articulated skull. This is horizontal plate of the palatine bone, and over here will be the perpendicular plate of palatine bone. So the posterior one third of hard palate is contributed by horizontal plate of palatine bone. Now let me connect both the individual palatine bones together, and that will form posterior one third of the hard palate. So they are connected like this. And now you can make out how posterior one third of hard palate is formed. Now there forms a suture in between these two, that is interpalatine suture. Similarly, there forms a suture between the maxilla, its palatine processes. So that is intermaxillary suture. So a continuous midline suture is formed between the maxilla and palatine bone, that is intermaxillary suture and interpalatine suture. So that will complete the entire suture of the hard palate. Similarly, you can see there is another suture at the junction of the maxilla and the palatine bone over here. So by and large, you can say there is a formation of a cruciform suture, and that is between the four bones. So this is how the hard palate is formed. Now let's see the bony features. You know the teeth. So these two are central incisors, and just behind central incisor, you can see over here there is a depression. This is called as incisive fossa. Now obviously above there lies nasal cavity. So this is a communication between the oral cavity over here and nasal cavity above. Now within the wall of incisive fossa there lies two incisive foramina. Let me show you by throwing a light. So right now you can see just a single incisive fossa, but if I throw light from the nasal cavity, you will clearly appreciate two incisive foramina. Can you see it? Okay, within the incisive fossa you will see two incisive foramina. Now as I mentioned, it's a connection between nasal cavity and oral cavity. So from the oral cavity, the greater palatine vessels will traverse along the hard palate and they will enter inside the nasal cavity. And similarly, from the nasal cavity, terminal portion of nasopalatine nerve will pass through these foramina and they will enter inside the oral cavity. Let me show you the same in the separate bone. So these two are maxilla, and if I join together, actually the palatine bones are also attached along with, so entire hard palate will be formed. And once I join these together, you can now make out formation of incisive fossa over here, and within the wall of incisive fossa you can appreciate the incisive foramina. The same you can appreciate over here. This is a wall of incisive foramina, and here you can see opening of the incisive foramina. Can you see this over here? So that is incisive foramina. Now other bony landmarks. As I mentioned, the hard palate is arched and pitted, and that is lodging palatine glands. Now in the horizontal plate of palatine bone, you will see a large foramen. That is greater palatine foramen. It's generally single foramen. It is called as greater palatine foramen. Now as I mentioned, it is found within the horizontal plate of palatine bone, just behind this suture. Now let me show you the same in the separate palatine bone. So these two are palatine bones, and over here you can appreciate the greater palatine foramen. Let me bring it a bit closer. Okay, over here you can appreciate. So this is horizontal plate, this is perpendicular plate, and over here you can appreciate greater palatine foramen. Now let me show you an articulated skull again. Here will be the greater palatine foramen, and just above to it, this portion belongs to the pterygopalatine fossa. So over here the oral cavity is connection with the pterygopalatine fossa, and the greater palatine vessels and anterior palatine nerve will come out from pterygopalatine fossa via this greater palatine foramen, and that will run towards incisive fossa. Generally there is a groove over here, but it's not clearly visible over here. But a groove is there, and that is lodging greater palatine vessels. So that is greater palatine foramen. Now posterior to that, you can see 2 to 3 lesser palatine foramina. Generally they are 2 to 3 number, and they are found posterior to the greater palatine foramen. Now these foramina are actually found within pyramidal process of the palatine bone. Let me show you. Now these are palatine bone. As I mentioned, it is horizontal plate, it is perpendicular plate, and at the junction of both these plate there is a process. This is called as pyramidal process of palatine bone. Now within pyramidal process, you can see over here, there is a foramen. Generally there are 2 to 3 number, here you can see only one. Now let me show you on left side. Yes, over here you can see 2 to 3 lesser palatine foramen. Now again, they are in connection above with the pterygopalatine fossa. So middle and posterior palatine nerves, they are emerging from this foramina and they enter into the oral cavity. Let me show you in another bone. These two are maxilla and there are palatine bones attached along with. And this is greater palatine foramen. And over here you can see 2 to 3 lesser palatine foramina. And above to it, over here will be, this is the territory of pterygopalatine fossa behind maxilla. This is perpendicular plate of the palatine bone. Over here, this is the territory of pterygopalatine fossa. So here also you can appreciate, if I throw a light beam, you can appreciate again. Yes, you can see the greater palatine foramen from the pterygopalatine fossa. Let me show you the same. Okay, that is visible now over here. So that is a connection between pterygopalatine fossa and the oral cavity. Now let's see another bony landmark that is found at the posterior free margin of the hard palate. Obviously it's made up of horizontal plate of palatine bone. It's very sharp and it limits the anterior third of the norma basalis, as well as that posterior free margin, it provides attachment to the palatine aponeurosis. Now when both the horizontal plate of palatine bone, they join in the midline, they form a spine or spine like structure, bony prominence, that is called as posterior nasal spine. Now this is a point which provides attachment to the musculus uvulae, one of the muscle of soft palate on either side. So this is about posterior free margin. Now one more thing, just in front of this posterior sharp free margin, there is an elevated area parallel to the posterior free margin. It's again concave and this is called as palatine crest. So the portion of hard palate from this palatine crest to the posterior free margin, this portion I'm talking, this is providing attachment to palatine aponeurosis. Now palatine aponeurosis is nothing but the aponeurosis of tensor velli palatini muscle, and it is basically forming framework of the soft palate. To it other muscles of the soft palate are attached. So here will be the attachment of the palatine aponeurosis. So this is about anterior one third of norma basalis. Now let's discuss middle one third of the norma basalis. Now in the middle one third of the norma basalis, the boundaries, you know, it extends from the posterior free margin of the hard palate to an arbitrary line or imaginary transverse line passing just in front of foramen magnum. Now again, this middle third, for descriptive purpose, it is subdivided into two parts, the median area and on either side lateral area. It extends up to the zygomatic arch. Now let's see what are the structures we can see in the median area. Now this portion, this is posterior border of the womer, posterior free margin or posterior border of the womer, and next to it will be the ala of womer. Then in the midline, at the junction of ala of womer with this portion, this is the body of sphenoid and it is continuous with basi occiput. So it's basically made up of two bones, body of sphenoid and basi occiput or basilar part of the occipital bone. So this is a thick bony bar, and at the junction of this body of sphenoid with the ala of the womer, there forms two canals. This canal is basically between ala of womer and the vaginal plate of, or vaginal process of, medial pterygoid plate. So these two canals are palatino-vaginal canal and vomero-vaginal canal. And most posteriorly, as I mentioned, there is a thick bony bar. So there are four structures we can see in the median area of middle third, namely the posterior border of womer, two canals, palatino-vaginal canal and vomero-vaginal canal, and thick bony bar that is made up of fusion of the basio occiput and body of sphenoid. Now let's see the woomer. So this is woomer bone, and it has got four borders: superior border, posterior border, inferior and anterior border. The superior border is found between two diverging ala over here, and posterior border is free. Now you can check the details in a separate video of woomer, but let me show you right now what is found in the midline. So this posterior free border with diverging ala are found like this. Okay. Now this diverging ala will come in contact with the body of sphenoid. So this is sphenoid, and these two are the wings. These two are the pterygoid plates, and in the center you can see body of the sphenoid. So here the ala of woomer will join like this. So that is what we see from behind, like this. Okay. Now in between the diverging ala and the vaginal process of medial pterygoid plate. This is medial pterygoid plate, and this is the vaginal process. You can clearly see there forms vomero-vaginal canal, and that details of that canal you can check in a separate video. Similarly, between the vaginal process of the medial pterygoid plate and the sphenoidal process of palatine bone, there is a formation of palatino-vaginal canal. That too you can check in detail with a separate video. Now remaining thing in the median plane is the thick bony bar. Now this is the thick bony bar in the center, and as you know, it is made up of fusion between the body of sphenoid and basio occiput. Now over here in the center you can see there is an elevation, and this is termed as pharyngeal tubercle. Now this pharyngeal tubercle will provide attachment to the uppermost fibers of the superior constrictor muscle. Now you know constrictors are forming wall of the pharynx. So here will be the uppermost fibers of superior constrictor. So this portion in front of the pharyngeal tubercle, this portion will form roof of the nasopharynx. Now on either side of the pharyngeal tubercle, this portion provides attachment to the longus capitis muscle, and the area behind the pharyngeal tubercle over here, in between pharyngeal tubercle and the foramen magnum, over here there will be attachment of the rectus capitis anterior muscle. So this is regarding the median area of the middle third of the norma basalis.